Patrick Foster, reporting to you with yet another episode in the Nash Heritage Preservation Project. The person we're going to talk to today was not actually connected with Nash Kelvinator. She is the daughter of a lady who was connected with Nash Kelvinator. And the woman that we're going to hear about is Helene Rother. Helene Rother is a very unique person in the history of Nash. She was a stylist for the automotive division, and she was one of the first women to be working in automotive styling in America. She came to the United States after World War II. Her story reads very much like Casablanca. She was had to escape from Paris and fled to Casablanca and was detained in a displaced persons camp there until she could obtain an exit visa to get out. She fled to Lisbon and then from there to America. She was given a job with General Motors, working in the styling department on interior styling, but left after a while to go to work for Nash Kelvinator. And she stayed there from 1949 to about 1955. So a great many of us in the Nash Club can thank Helene Rother for the beautiful interior styling that we see in our automobiles. Helene Rother unfortunately passed away a few years ago, but we were able to track down her daughter, who traveled with her during this exit from Europe and came over with her to America as a young child. And her daughter, Ina Rother, was able to give us some photos, which will intersperse throughout this film so that you'll be able to see some of the work that Helene Rother did for us. The name, I'm sure, is familiar to Nash people because Helene Rother's name is mentioned in several of the Nash sales catalogs and in press releases. But unfortunately, you don't see too many photos of Helene. And I've been looking for her myself for many years, and I think in 12 years of trying, I've come up with only one or two. But today we're going to be able to see a great many of them, courtesy of her daughter. So without further ado, we'll go on to the interview and intersperse throughout that, and afterwards you'll be able to see photos of Helene Rother's work, okay? I know you're going to enjoy this. Thanks a lot. My name is Patrick Foster, automotive historian and author, and we are welcoming you back today to another segment in the Nash Heritage Preservation Project. As you know, over the past few years, we've interviewed designers, engineers, Nash automobile dealers. One person that I've always been fascinated by, and I've been unlucky in trying to track her down, and that was Helene Rother, who was a Nash automotive designer. Ms. Rother worked under Ed Anderson and under Vice President Dean Moore, designing the interiors of Nash automobiles. The lady we have with us today is Dr. Ina Rother, the daughter of Helene Rother, and she's going to tell us about her mother's career with Nash and some bits and pieces about her mother's life. Your mother had a fascinating life. She moved here from Europe?
That's right.
Where did she live in Europe?
Well, we lived in Paris, except we didn't have Nash. And we were there until the Germans came.
In World War II?
World War II. And we escaped to the south. And then we left Marseille. And we were on the boat to Martinique, because it's the only place you could get a boat to. And at that time, you really didn't care where you were going, as long as you were leaving. And the British intercepted it, and they found that besides all the passengers they stuffed in there, they had a little ammunition underneath that the French were trying to sneak out, I guess, or I don't know. And so we were left in Casablanca, and they took us off the boat, finally. Couldn't stay there forever. And they put us in a lovely concentration camp I really liked. It was actually an army camp where they had taken out some of the army people to facilitate us. We were the ones, you know, the ones that ended up there were mostly the families, and there were a few prisoners there. They were interesting too. And otherwise, there were still some Arab units, or I don't know. And
you were just a young girl then.
Yes, I was.
Yeah.
I was 7 going on leave. And then we were in Africa about 2 months altogether, I think. And then we got on another boat and we came to New York. And my mother was actually sponsored by, that's another story. was sponsored by Mr. Monet, which is actually Mr. Chernow. He got a sense of this country because you couldn't just, now everybody walks in. I don't know how you do it. But he was nice enough to sponsor us because she had designs for him in Paris. And when she got there, she went back to her old trade, starting to make these collections for jewelry, gloves, and all
that. Yeah, that was her background.
Well, that's what she'd done in Paris, you know.
Design jewelry.
As I say, when you go into art, you better find an angle because mm-hmm. you just don't go out and say, can I just talk to you?
Yeah.
Is that art? Okay. You can't just say, I am an artist. Yay.
Yeah.
Okay, so she was doing that, and then the war broke out. And nobody made jewelry anymore. Everybody went in the war after it. I don't know what a jewelry company was, probably for Scoob or something, with a, you know, an airplane. And so she found a job with, I forgot the exact name of the company she did that. Jimmy Jupiter.
Mm-hmm.
She liked that. That was fun.
Now that was in America?
Oh, yeah, that was in America.
Oh, okay.
The name of the company that is there, I'm trying to think of who the main... I think the submariner was in that comic book, but the first one was a guy that was all on fire. That's been a year or two ago, that was
Jesus. Hmm.
Okay, and then she answered the ad, as I mentioned, in the paper that she talked the designer to go to Detroit.
Now that was in a New York paper?
It was in the Times Press.
Okay. The ad in the New York paper was for a designer. The ad was placed by General Motors, and it was for a designer to work in Detroit. And at that time, the two women were living in New York. So she traveled out there to interview?
She must have, I imagine. But they offered her, like, say, a very nice salary. She didn't really want to go to Detroit. She was not an industrial designer, really frustrating. But she didn't provide. Well, they could use them today. Just in the interior places, they could.
Oh, yeah.
Stuck.
Yeah.
But, and so she worked for General Motors because at that time we were at war. So that was all, they just kept, she didn't know what to do with herself because they were just all there. They were there, you know, they weren't making any cars, so they were making some advanced design.
Yeah.
But, you know, and she was there too. When she started at General Motors, I mean, she was there until she lost her job there. And
when she went to work at Nash, I believe, in 1947?
Yeah, that would be right, 47, 48, something like that.
Yeah.
And then she worked for Nash as a consultant.
Yeah. Now, when she got the job at General Motors, my feeling, looking over the old documents, is that she, because she was a jewelry designer, she didn't have a background in industrial design. It must have just been her strength of will to go in there and apply for a job that she wasn't really qualified for.
Yes.
And get it.
Oh,
and
yes.
So she must have had a little bit of a selling personality.
Oh, she had a selling personality like you've never seen.
Oh,
she was
okay.
The original kind of man.
The best designers were, though. That's what they always said about the top people, is that they were natural.
Well, you know, she just said you need to improve your looks of the interior of the cars, you know, and she could pick out nice, appropriate, you know, as you see in some of her designs, nice, appropriate materials that look
mm-hmm.
nice, and we did the dashboards a little bit, and et cetera, et cetera.
But now, when you moved out to Detroit, where did you live?
Well, we lived in an apartment, because it was terribly hard to find any place to live in those days, so we lived at 999 Wetmore Road, which is in Palmer Park, you know, Detroit, and then she bought that old house on Chicago Boulevard, which is a fancy old section of Detroit. It's the Edison. Edison had a house there once. But the neighborhood was changing already. We didn't ever afford it. She bought that house, and she did her business she had a studio, you see.
Inside the house.
It was inside the house. She worked from there, and we lived up. Well, we lived
now,
all over.
When she worked in Nash, did she work out of her own house or at the
She worked out of her own house.
Oh, okay.
Well, she was down there a lot, you know, as a consultant,
mm-hmm.
but she didn't actually have an office or anything.
Oh, okay. Now, the year that she started, I'm going to have to see if I can figure that out, because 1948 would have been when Ed Anderson started as the head of Nash Styling, and so I tend to think maybe it was then, but Nash did do some styling stuff before then, but it came under the direction of the engineering department.
Yeah, well, I couldn't tell you about that.
Yeah, I've seen pictures of her with the vice president of engineering, so it could be either way. But I know she did work with Ed Anderson. And did you ever get to meet him while you were a little girl? He was a...
Oh, I wasn't a little girl then anyway, but I can't remember him. I met some of these people.
Mm-hmm.
But I wonder if that's who that was.
Yeah.
copies, I guess.
I'm looking through some pictures here, and I'm going to have my photo editor put these in here. But very interesting. You have a picture of her with Ken and Serena looking at details of a car. Did you meet him when you were
there? Yes, I think I did meet him.
Oh, okay. And then she's here with some Nash people and also Ken and Serena. She traveled to an auto show in Paris and took a lot of pictures there.
Yes, she took a lot of pictures.
And she wrote an article for a newspaper I saw. Did she do any other writing?
Oh, she loved to write, but that was on her own. She was no writer. She wasn't even that fluent in English. I would not correct some of her writings.
And she retained her accent?
Yeah, she always retained her accent.
Oh, okay.
Well, she got it when she was 30 years.
Here's a photo of Helene back in the days when she was working for Nash. And we're probably going to have Paul put these in greater focus, but I just wanted to show her. And she worked out of the house. I can see her studio here.
Some of those studios, when she first went to work for herself, she took an office with our lawyer in the Fisher Building for a while before she bought the house. So she must have been, I'm remembering. This is the house on Chicago Boulevard, but there's one picture. She had an office there when she started out. The first thing she had was a little show.
Oh, yeah.
And invited all these, little shows. Yeah. I guess, interior cars or something. That's what's coming back to me now. Yeah.
She was a real showman.
Yeah, she was a showman. That was on the 16th floor of the Fisher Building.
Now, I got to tell you what impresses me about this picture of her at work drawing. She's got all her tools. She's got the lights and everything. She's beautifully dressed. She's got her jewelry on. She's got her hair all done. She's home.
But I think there was a professional photographer. No, but she always kept herself. She didn't run around like the rest of us.
In picture after picture, she's always beautifully dressed.
Oh, she did like to dress.
Where did she buy her clothes? In Detroit or Paris?
No, she bought them here. That suit came from Demery's.
Okay.
We used to shop there a lot. It's right there by the Fisher Building.
Yeah, and here's another one. She's just beautifully dressed, and her hair is so perfect. This looks like it was taken in the
show in
Paris. Yeah. Now, is this on Chicago Avenue?
Yes, that's Chicago Boulevard.
Chicago Boulevard. We'll see if we can show this up for the camera, too. And yet, a woman back in those days, she was, I think, the first woman car designer.
Yes, she was. There's another one floating around here at General Motors, but she was the first one.
Mm-hmm. Did you ever talk about that when you were a kid and say, I'm the first person who's the first woman who's been doing this?
Oh, I'm sure she told me that.
Yeah, but you were a teenager and you didn't think you blocked it out.
Yeah, you know how teenagers are. They're interested in everything.
Yeah.
Your mother's career.
So she worked at Nash Motors, we're going to say probably starting in 1947. I know we've seen advertisements with her picture in there.
Mm-hmm.
There was a Jackson Award Nash was given the award, the Jackson Award for custom interiors, but they have her picture in there with Ken and Selena because she really created the design. Yeah. Do you know how long she worked at Nash?
Well,
the
session came, and I think
that would have been probably about 54. Mm-hmm. Does that sound about right?
I couldn't tell you the exact date, but they ought to have it in the history of American Motors.
No, we're doing this right now.
Yeah, but I mean, someplace they've got records of who worked for them and who they terminated. But I know that when she, it's one of these recessions, so of course you get rid of all the people that you used to get rid of because you want to cut.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Just like they're doing now.
Did your mother drive?
Oh, yes, she drove. She was when she finally totaled the last car, my Toyota, and we took her off the road, that was a blessing to all of us.
But when she first moved to America, did she drive?
A little bit.
Yeah.
But we didn't have a car until 46.
Oh.
But she was terrible. I mean, just terrible. Ask anybody who's ever ridden with her, they said it's a lifetime.
Did she ever get a ticket, though?
Oh, I'm sure she got some tickets.
Oh, I can't imagine. I can't imagine any police officer stopping a beautiful woman like that and giving her a ticket. Particularly a woman of charm in
her. Well, I don't know. She probably, She probably talked herself out of quite a few of them, but I'm sure she got some pickups in a few. Her driving was. Well, she's always in a hurry, too, when she's younger.
Do you remember what cars, what kind of cars she owned?
Oh, yeah.
Did she have a Nash?
Oh, yes.
Mm-hmm.
First car we got was a 1946 Buick when they first came out. Mm-hmm. That was a mistake. Because where they have dogs, they hadn't made them in so long.
Yeah.
And then we, I think we had a Buick convertible, which we sold because we just got it.
Yeah.
And then she had that blue Nash Rambler. And then she had a Nash.
Ambassador?
Well, I think the blue one was an Ambassador, but it's like a little coupe thing. You know, mm-hmm. I mean, it was a four-seater, but it was, I might probably have some pictures of it. And then she had that big one, which she pulled. And then later on, she had an Ambassador at the end that she got from her boyfriend.
Mm-hmm.
Because he bought something different that she pulled. Oh, my.
Quite a character.
Yeah, she was that.
Yeah.
She made her way in life. She enjoyed life, and she, you know, she always said that she enjoyed excitement, and this is true, because back in 1978, because I have a picture of her sister came over from France and brought all her medical things.
Mm-hmm.
She was actually pretty healthy. She lived to be 80, which was not too far around the corner, but she had her x-rays, and she had her blood pressure medicine, which wasn't taken at that time. We took everybody's blood pressure, and my aunt Liz was 140 over 80. Mine was 140 over 80, and mother's was 120 over 80. She didn't, I mean, stress probably put some people out, but not her. She
left the car business in 54, and then did she go back to designing jewelry, or did she get
no,
to the church window?
No, I think next was the church window.
She went out to design church windows.
You see, if you look at her resume, she had contracts with the undertaking. She did it. Wait, work.
Let me explain that, because they're going to think that you're talking about a funeral home. She had a contract with Miller Meteor, the company that produced ambulance bodies, and she helped design those.
The interior. We wanted a more beautiful interior for your body.
And beautiful.
Yeah.
Beautiful work, too.
And she did, for a good year, she did, a tennis shoe?
Mm-hmm.
Cadets, actually, cadets.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because that was Goodyear. I know that if you bought Sears, which I think was a little cheaper, it's the same shoe, you know, because they bought that. And then she did. There's a list of all her companies that she did things for. What else did she work for? She was always hustling for another, you know, somebody else to do something for, make some money. But she always had to make money. And if you think it's hard to be the only woman, the first woman designer, think of how hard it is to have a child to support, you know, and have to make a decent living doing that kind of work.
Yeah. I'm going to read now just a summary of some of the work that she did. 1941, beginning of the United States entering into the war, terminated the model making of most jewelers in America, which ended her pretty much... ended her career in jewelry here. 1942, she was an illustrator for Funnies Incorporated, a newspaper service studio. And she drew...
Jimmy Cupid.
That was it a cartoon strip or a comic
book? No, it's a comic book. You know, it comes out every month. And I think the main one was a torch. And then there was a submariner, and then there was Jimmy Cupid, and then there was something else. But it was a regular...
Wow. Funnies Incorporated. Now, those are ones I didn't... There was a cartoon character years later, the Human Torch. I wonder if they're related. But she wrote.
She drew it. She don't write it. You know, they give you the layout, and you just fill in each picture.
Wow. And how long did she do that? Do you remember?
Not very long.
Oh, okay.
Well, we came here in 43, and everything ended. We came to Detroit in 43. We came to New York in 41, and I think by 42, she was hustling that for about a year.
Yeah, it says here 42. 43, it says she joined General Motors styling section in charge of fashioned interiors and stayed there until 1947. Okay, so here it is. It does say 1947 to 1955. American Motors. Now, that's important for two reasons. 1947 means that she was hired by Mead Moore, who was in charge of engineering back then. And so she was in the styling section even before Ed Anderson. And to be let go in 1955 meant that they must have considered her very needed, because they got rid of a lot of people in 53 and especially 54. So if she left the 55, that was one thing that she must have been one of the last to be let go. And then, from 1941 on, successfully worked as a design consultant for Mengel Furniture Company, Stromberg Carlson, Magnavox, Samuel Kirk Sterling Silverware Manufacturer, International Harvester. And what did she do for International Harvester?
Heat freezers. Refrigerators. You want an ugly-looking, boxy thing? You want a stylish.
Elgin Rubber. Oh, no, Elgin American. U.S. Rubber Company.
Yeah, Elgin American. That's a watch, isn't
it? I think so, yeah.
Yeah, so she has a little more jewelry probably.
Oh, okay. U.S. Rubber Company. B.F. Goodrich Company. The Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company. And others. And you said it. Goodyear.
I know it was the shoes. I don't know what she picked for those other rubber companies.
Oh, okay. So she and when did she retire?
She never retired.
Oh, okay.
Well, in 1969, her boyfriend dropped dead, and as I said, he was a civil engineer. He measured all of that.
All the windows.
And all the windows. So I don't think she did anything.
And what year did she pass away?
1999. She was 91 years old. But she wasn't too good the last few years.
Wow.
She got glaucoma in her eyesight for a very good year. Mm-hmm. Yeah, she lived 20 years after she took cancer. And she came to the farm to go back.
Looking at the pictures of her when she moved to America and when she went to Lisbon and Casablanca, she just reminds me so much of Ingrid Bergman. She's a beautiful woman traveling from wartime Europe to America.
Yeah, but she wasn't Ingrid Bergman. She was it. She was Humphrey Bogart.
She was not a shrinking violet.
No, she was not a shrinking violet. You had to do things. We were in Africa. We had some money in Martinique.
Mm-hmm.
And now the point is to get a passage on the boat, on some boat that's going that way. There weren't that many. And you don't really have any money, and you've got to get something from the French government or some government. You know how bureaucracy is.
Mm-hmm.
And I think when we left the camp, we didn't have any money. So we got the Casablanca. There were a lot of characters in the camp. And so we're walking down the street with our luggage. We didn't have a lot of luggage, is what you could carry, I guess. And here comes this count something or other in a carriage. You know, they have this horse carriage. And Mrs. Rother, how nice to see you. Who do we offer you a ride? She said, well, this is a break. And so she hops in the carriage, and the only reason he invited her is he didn't have any money for the cab either. They all had to go pick up their money.
Now, when you were in Africa and in a camp waiting to see if you can escape to America, did you ever think that you'd live in New York, you'd live in Detroit, your mother would be a...
No, I never thought about it. I don't know what you think about it as a child. I was having fun there. I loved Africa.
Yeah.
Oh, I just loved it.
And New York must have been exciting, but Detroit...
I like New York. Well, Detroit was all right, but I never had as much fun in Detroit as we used to have in New York.
Yeah. Well, everybody likes it.
And then I got older, and things changed. New York's a fun town.
Yeah.
For kids. We ran to the Museum of Natural History. We lived on 25 West 85th Street,
mm-hmm.
right there on the west side, and then we ran over across the park. The Metropolitan, the Rumminster down there. I wonder if I don't think kids are different nowadays. You kept your mouth shut.
Well, I want to thank you for giving us these insights into your mother. Is there anything else you'd like to tell us about her that helps us know her a little bit better?
She was also a horse trainer. We started in racehorses, and she decided she'd do it herself.
Yeah.
She also did that, but I can think she was still in the church with us at the same time.
What a remarkable woman.
Yes, she was a remarkable woman.
And it's that sort of person, I think, that ended up in Nash, because Nash, I mean, it just seemed like it nurtured creative people and interesting people. Did beautiful work. I think anybody who's got a Nash from about 1947 on to 56 or 57 would agree that the interior trim far surpasses any of the other American cars of the period. And it's, I think we can thank her good taste and her grace and her insight. So, again, thank you very much. And that wraps it up for today. And I'll see you the next time with the next installment of the Nash Heritage Preservation Project.
Hello again.